Okay, so hello everyone. So today we will test unit testing of React apps. We are using Jest. So Jest is a library. So why should we test? So what's the reason we should test our apps? Shouldn't we just push it live, right? So writing a test case enables you that every time you make a small change, everything you started doing on the first day to till now, everything will be tested in a matter of minutes. So that's why you should write test cases, so that moving forward, whenever the code base is really huge and you want to pretty much test everything you have developed since the first day, pretty much everything gets tested in 1 minute. So that's why you should write test cases. And so what Jest? So Jest is a JavaScript testing framework developed and backed by Facebook. So you can use Jest for pretty much everything, testing anything which has JavaScript in. It supports TypeScript, Node, React, Angular, Vue, and any Node application. So we'll just dive in right directly with the introduction of Jest. Okay. So let's start. Let's start with something simple. So just create a directory and do npm init in it and npm I Jest. Okay. So you save as dev dependency. Okay. So those of you are following along can do npm init and install Jest. Okay. So create a new directory. So I've already created directory and do npm init. So npm init. And then install npm I Jest. So this is, so I have this very simple, fairly simple function. So what it does is adds two numbers. So it will return the output of two numbers. I have added a condition basically to make it look a little more complex. Okay. So what we'll do, we'll test this function using Jest. So in the same directory, so in the for unit test cases, the convention we prefer is that whatever the files are in their folder, so we create a folder underscore test again two times underscore, and we pretty much put all the test cases in there. Okay, so that's there in the some test JS, and in the test I have written a test case. Okay, so this is the test case. So just import the some function. You can create your own some function and import that. So one more thing you need to configure Jest is that go to package.json, and in the test it must have something default like echo something, replace it with Jest. So that we are basically telling that for test we are using Jest. Okay. In the package.json. Okay, once you have created your own sum function and then created a folder underscore tests underscore and create a new file in sum, the convention is dash and test, the name of the file dash test and .js. Okay, so import that sum function and then we will write a pretty simple test. So what it does is adds 1 plus 2 equals to 3. This is basically name of the test. So it's a description that, okay, this is the test I'm running. And then I'll use the sum function I've imported. I'll pass it two arguments, 1 and 2. And I expect this to be 3. So basically the sum of 1 and 2, I expect it to be 3. Okay. So I'll run this now. So you can run this using npm run test. Okay, so there was one test case which was passed in. So one more thing you can do is you can pass an extra argument coverage. So what it does, it tells you that, okay, these are the lines which will be covered, these are the branches, or these are the conditions. So these are the control flows which has been covered in these tests. So I'll run this with the coverage flag and see what happens. So basically it generates a coverage folder and it puts the report, whatever the coverage report, in there. Double hyphen is like once you're running a program inside a program. So double hyphen means that whatever arguments we are passing after that should be passed through the program, the sub-program which you... Yeah, so we need to pass coverage to Jest, okay? So, but we are npm run script, so npm will pass these arguments to the program it runs inside. So let's add two more test cases. So basically, I've added 12 plus 2. So it will be pretty much same, the flow will be same, but 12 plus minus 2 basically. So one of them is negative, so it will go in else. So all the statements should be covered now. Let's try it again. Okay. So the code coverage says 100%, 100%. So this is the stat that, okay, these are is covered. If you want to see the more detailed version, again you can, yeah, so sum to JS, you see the green line, and if statement has been executed 3 times because there were 3 test cases, twice it went to return A plus B, and in one time it was negative, so it went to that. Okay, so basically it tells you how many times the statement has been tested, which statements are not tested. So coverage pretty much gives you the complete idea. Okay, so now I have added another function, so it will multiply the two number and return that. It's simple. So now let's say we want to test with objects. So right now we tested that, okay, 2B10, 2B12, so it was simple value. You can simply, so if you want to test with objects, so what you can do, so let's say index.html, okay, so this function returns an object, okay, so it adds both number and returns as a sum, and it multiplies both number and returns as a multiple. So let's run this as well. Or see, this multiply, I have not written any test cases for this, like directly, but since I'm testing this index.js which includes multiply, it should be tested, right? So let's run it with coverage again. So all files, Jest introduction, pretty much everything has been covered 100%. Let's see how many times each. Let's see the report. Okay. So there were two folders, Jest introduction and then Jest introduction source. So Jest introduction source has sum and multiply. So even the multiply has been tested, okay, because we have included it in other test cases. Okay, and this was executed 4 times, 3 and again. And Jest introduction, basically index.js file. So this has been also tested. So you can test your objects like this. So matches are basically help functions which, so for example, let's say right now we have only tested 2B, so which directly equals that, okay, 2B6, 2B7. So let's say we want to perform different operations. In case of objects, we perform that 2B equal, For strings, we want to check okay whether this string contains this. For truth boolean, we want to check whether it's true or false. So different. So basically, the matchers are based to compare these those things. So let's say I have two functions, compare. So compare, what it does is returns A is greater than B, true or false, and the function which gets you custom greeting. Okay, so custom greeting means whatever the name you pass. Let's say I pass Divyanshu, and so it will return hello Divyanshu. Okay. So that's custom greeting. So these are the both the functions we so let's write test cases for this. Okay, so test cases for this would be compare function. So I'm comparing 5 and 12. So comparing 5 and 12 should return true or false. So whether 5 is greater than or not. False, right? So I'm expecting compare 5 12 to be false. Okay, so this is the helper function just writes to be false to. So that's the comparison function for string. Well, I have passed the name Jest, so I would expect that whatever the greeting comes in, it should match, it should have the name Jest in it, right? Yeah, that's how it works. So let's run the test cases for these as well. So pretty much all the files has been 100% coverage. Some measures. So all this has been tested as well. That's okay. So these are not the only measures. So let's go. So there are multiple other as well. So the most common we have used are to be, to equal, to not. So you can add not as well, not to be or not equal. And the truth and false, you can compare to be null, to be defined, to be undefined, to be truthy, to be falsy. So all these are for basically truthiness. And then numbers, for number also has all those functions, to be greater, to be lesser than equal, to be equal. Or for floating point, so if you 0.1 plus 0.2, you will to be 0.2, 0.3, it will not be equal. So these are float numbers. Okay, so to be close to 0.3, that would give you that okay, this is zero. So that would work. For strings, you can to match, you can pass regex as well. For array, you can say to contain. For example, you have an array of 10 elements and you want to check whether or not this contains this particular element. So this would do to contain. And you can also check for exceptions. So what exception it was throwing. So let's say you want this program to fail, right? You want this program to throw an exception. So you can check whether this program is throwing right exception or not. Okay, so you can check what with the error message or basically class of the error. So you can do as well. So these are the very common measures Jest has. Okay, let's say you want to test an async function. So how do you deal with an async function? So if you put in directly, let's say, okay, so I'll go through the documentation. So if you put in it, if you do it directly, like something like that, okay, function callback, so it won't, the expect data will not be executed. So because the program has already closed. So there are multiple ways to do that, okay. So either the function, till now we are passing it the empty function, we are not taking any argument. So the first parameter will be done, a function. So you can call that, then it will be done. Otherwise for promises, you can return a promise. So it will wait for that promise to resolve. Okay, so that's how you can deal with asynchronous code. Okay, so that's about introduction of Jest. So let's jump to Redux and like this. Unless you want to try out a few more examples of testing Jest first, then we should jump. Okay, React JS and Redux. So testing, if we are using React, so for Redux is very common thing to go along with. So what it does, it separates the view, so basically the HTML and part, with the data. So it basically adds an extra abstraction, so data is completely held separate. So you can, it makes testing much more easier. So using Redux has one more benefit, that you can completely test without the view, so without how it's viewing and all. So you can completely test pretty much all the logic part of your app. Okay, so those of you who are not aware with Redux, so what we do in Redux, we dispatch an action. So basically we tell, okay, that user is logged in. So that's the dispatching an action. So it will do all the work. Okay, so that, okay, fetching data and from the server and all, and then we basically dispatch action to reducer. Okay, so what? So Redux has a global store. So global store means that the complete data is at a single place. So all the data related to application is at one place. So our whole purpose is that whatever changes we want to make, for example, user is logged out, so we need to clear all the details of user, right? So that changes, so basically clearing that those details to of user, so that has to be done in the store. DOM testing also can be done as well, but we will pretty much focus on testing the Redux, because that's where the complete heart of front-end application is, if we are using Redux. So by the time it compiles, so in this I have created a really small feature. So what it does is, so GitHub has this API, so where you give the username, it will give you details of all the user. So we are basically using this API. So anyone up to tell their username? Anyone? Username? Spell? Okay, so Tanmay Mohan, he has public 38, public repos, one public Jest, follower 17, following 45, company bits, please, MSI. Okay, so, and he has a blog, tanmaymohan.com. Okay, so these are all the details we catch from Facebook, his GitHub account. So basically the whole this is a very simple search box. So what you do is you type in username of, and it will fetch all these data, like, okay, his repo, followers, following. There is other bunch of data coming in, so we didn't show it here. And you can simply click and see his profile. Okay. So this is the application. So what it involves is that getting this data, getting the username, hitting the API from GitHub, and fetching that data, then putting that data in store and using the data sure. Okay, so that's the complete flow of this feature. Okay, so without the UI, so UI is I did last, so before that, so the UI usually the UI is what we see while testing, right? So we should see UI, that whether it's working or not, right? So but the UI was done developed at the end, so when the everything has been developed, so we only integrated the UI in it. Okay, so this was done in the last, so let's start from the step one. Okay, so I already set up Redux and all, but I won't go on those details, so I'll simply go to actions. So we should have an action. What it does, it should fetch the data from GitHub, and then it should dispatch an action that, okay, user has been fetched and this is the user data. And if it fails, then it should dispatch an action that user fetched fail. User fetching, okay, that's typo. So it should dispatch an action that, okay, this action has been failed. Okay, so these are the two actions which will go in this. Okay, so I'll simply give you quite a simple brief. Okay, so API get user. So basically this gets you the API endpoint. So API URL. So this is user slash username. Okay, so that's how the URL was. So I have already pre-configured it for the base URL of GitHub. So I get the whatever the username I pass, so we get URL for that. And after that, the API is basically an Axios instance. We get, hit using get, and then the response is fetched. Okay. So, but for testing purpose, we won't actually hit the GitHub. Okay. So how the testing works is that when you're unit testing, you don't want to test whether the server APIs are sending the right result, whether the Axios is working correct. You just want to check whether this function you write for this specific purpose of fetching the data and then dispatching these actions. So the whole concept of unit test is that we will only test that at a time. Okay, so how do we manage that? Okay, how do we manage this API get? Basically, so it's part of function. How do we manage that? This will stay as it is, because if we are changing it and then testing, there's no meaning of testing. You change it back, then you need to test it. Right? Okay, so there's this concept of mocking. So whatever which is not in our current environment, which is not a part of current feature, we mock that. So basically we so this api.get should give us some data. We mock that, okay, that this is the data was given to us. So for this I'm using this package. So okay, so this is the user data we have test. And then after that I mock the store to be null. So right. Yeah, so this is not really needed in this, because we are not actually updating anything on the store, because we are just dispatching. Okay, so and the expected action. So what you can, the whole purpose of action is to dispatch. So basically dispatch something. Okay, so we will simply say that, okay, this is what we expect this function should dispatch. Okay, so we are telling that it should dispatch action user fetch. Since it's 200, it should dispatch user fetch, not the failed. So we know that this is what will be dispatched, and this is the data it should dispatch, because this is the data we told Axios that, okay, return this data. So this is the data should be dispatched. So that's how the function works. And then the actual work, stored or dispatch, get username, so calling that function. Okay, so which we are testing. So get user was the function we are testing, and then so I have written this promise. So basically it will wait for that promise to resolve, and then I expect store.get actions. So this gives you store.get. You can be get all the actions which are pending in the store right now. Okay, so which have been dispatched but not processed. Okay, so you get action to be equal to expected actions. So those are the actions should be. So that's how you test an action in Redux. Yeah, so it's an array, because it can dispatch multiple. For example, right now I've only done user fetch. Let's say you want to do something like fetching user. Initially you dispatch fetching user, then once user is fetched, you want to dispatch user has been fetched. Okay, so there can be multiple actions, right? In this case there is only one, but there can be multiple. That's why it's an array, and we compare that, okay, all these actions has been dispatched more than one, if it's more than one. Okay, so let's run this. Okay, so you can keep it running. So React has all this configuration. So you just need to run it once, and every time you make, while coding, every time you make a change, it will automatically run those test cases which has been done since last change. So last time, let's say you have added two functions, and now you have added third one. So it will only run those files which you made changes recently. Okay, so it will automatically, you need not to run it again. So it will automatically work out. So let's say I do, okay, so now initially it was user was fetched successfully. Let's say now user fetching user has failed. Okay, so. Okay, so as soon as it detected changes, it will run this test again. Okay, so let's okay, let's say we put some random username which user did not find. So the default behavior of Axios would be it will return it 404 and that some data that user not found. Okay, in that case, our function should dispatch a different action. Okay, so it should be user fetch failed, and then we will expect that, okay, that the fetch has been failed. So this is what we'll test. Okay, so this is, I think, test case already ran. Yeah. Let's go to coverage. Okay, so coverage is not working right now. So it has something to do with that all changes are already committed. So if it, so that's why I think it's not working. Okay, let's not dispatch this action and see what happens. Okay, so it failed. So it expected this an array. Basically, this has been dispatched, but it received nothing. So it is telling that, okay, one test has been failed, and this is where it failed. this is what it was expecting, and that's something where it go wrong. So like when working, if you make changes to some other feature or something, if you mistake by mistake, if you do something which changes which changes the schema or the things this expect, so it will fail. So it will immediately tell you, okay, this is what it was expecting at there, and it failed. So maybe you should have a look that whether it was intentional or it was by mistake. So that can help you a lot. Okay, so let's test producer now. So action is where all the work happens, that fetching data, dispatching actions, but you don't actually manipulate the state there. So for that, you go to reducer, and so that's where the data in the store is updated. Okay, so you need to test reducer as well. Okay, so we have this user reducer. So what it does is, if user fetched, so if the action is of type user fetched, so it will store user. So this is the initial state. So user null, username null, fetch failed false. So this is the initial state of the store. So when nothing is when your app loads first time, this will be the state that will be picked up. So right now in different system, the user is not there, neither is the username. Or fetch failed is basically I've kept a flag that whether or not we tried to fetch something and it failed. Okay, so that's what it is for. Okay, now let's say user is fetched. So what we'll do is we'll update state with the user whatever the data came from Axios, and then username from action.user.login. So in the GitHub API, in the login you get username. So that's why the login is there. And fetch failed is false, because even though it is initially false, let's say the fetch failed, failed, for example, once you try to search for some random word and it failed, so but then you fetch a user. Okay, so then it should it was a bit true, right? So it became true. So you need to make it false explicitly, right? So you should not miss these things. Okay, so test this one. Okay, so first we will test for empty state. For example, this is the initial state and this is the action. Okay, so initial state is undefined when the app loads, right? So this is the initial state, and this is the initial state, and this is the second bracket is action it was dispatched. So right now, when the app loads, it is initial state is empty, undefined, and the action is empty, action is triggered. So let's try to run it. So just look at this state and see that, okay, once the user has fetched, what should happen here. So in user we should put that data that, okay, now we have a user, so this is the data we are. So this is basically the global state where all the data resides. Okay, so in the global state, now that we have a user, we should have that user in this data, right? So it should be there, the username should be there, whether or not fetch has failed, it should be false, right? The fetch was successful, that's why the user has fetched. So this is exactly what we'll, so this was the state, this is exactly what we have done here. So we have pushed a user in it, username in, and fetch failed as false. So once the user is fetched, what will be this state? Login key. And fetch will, this will be the four, right? So this is exactly what we need to do when testing. So we have dispatched something, we have dispatched user fetched, and we have with the data as user mock data. So once we run this reducer, what we expect that user should have this data, mock data dot user, username should have this mock data dot user dot login, and fetch will should be false. This is what we should expect, right? Okay, so that's done. So let's write one more test case. So let's say we are trying to fetch and it failed, the user is not there. So what we would do is we would set user to null, username to null, and fetch fail to true, right? So this is what we would expect. So this is reducer's initial state. So to save the space, so I have saved it in a variable on the top. Yeah, so this was the initial state. So on initial state, fetch failed happened. So this is what we would expect, right? The fetch failed, user should be null, username should be null, and fetch failed should be true. So this would run fine. Let's say there was already some data in the user and username, and fetch failed was false. And then we try to fetch a new another book. Let's say you are searching for something, the results are already there. So the you are already seeing somebody's GitHub profile, and you want to search something else, and then you hit enter. So what would you expect? So the and it fails. So what would you expect? That the existing results should be there on the page. So let's say you are searching for football, and so you have all the results of football. Next you search for cricket. Okay. So and it fails. So the football results should already be there or not? No. Yeah, so most of the use cases would want to show that okay, whatever you're trying to fetch is failed. So we would remove those results and put it there. Okay. So in this case, so we already has one user and fetch will false and then it failed. So should we reset it or so in this use case we are expecting that user should not be there, username should not be there, and fetch will should be true. Okay, but it is failing. Okay, so it was expecting that user and username should be null, but the existing user and username were already there.
Okay. Basically, we search for user who exists.
Before we search for, so before searching for a wrong, we search for a right. So that data is already in there in the store. Okay. So let's say I search for Nikhil, and next I search for some random word. So Nikhil's data is already there in the. I would still be seeing Nikhil's data, but in our program we expect that okay, then you search for a username which does not exist, so it should show that okay, this user does not exist. So yeah, so yeah, so that's let's see why this happened. Because in reducer we saw this and we said okay, we only need to set fetch failed as true. We forgot about the rest, so we need to keep our other keys as well with each action. So. Okay, so now we have done is we have said one fetch fails, user as null and username as null. Okay. So this would give us the test case passed, and the last part of this is so what I have done is I have connected store with my component. So user username fetch failed and action as well. So get user is an action. So this is right. So on search user I am dispatching that okay get user and then if the data comes in. So this is my view. So if there is a user, we should show this data, right? The user's name, the complete card of user, we should show it to. And if the fetch is failed, then we should show that user not found on GitHub. Okay. And on search, we will simply dispatch this action search user. So it is taking a username and then it is doing all the work. So in the last, I've integrated with the UI. Okay. So let's see again. Okay, so I type the username in the search bar and I enter. So it. So see, the action which was dispatched was user fetched. So initial stage was that okay, user is null, user failed is false, and user name was null. So then I have fetched user. So this was the data that came in, and the next state is that user has this all this data. Okay. So this was one action we performed. Let's try something which is not there. Okay. So see, initial state we had something in user, but it failed. So user would be null, username should be null, and fetch failed should be true. And since fetch failed is true, so we have done edit user not found in GitHub. Okay. Any questions? So you can try add. So there are few more APIs. So you can get all the name of the repos. Yeah. So you can get name of all the repos and all. So if you want to try it out, you want to run write a few test cases of your own, use another API from this and integrate in this project as only. So I'll give you the URL of the code of, and you can build it up on this project, existing project. Take the reference. Okay. So I guess. Okay, so that brings me to the end of this. Okay, thank you. Listen.